wanted to welcome you all tonight. You know, the world may be in chaos, but we're learning that the Bible shares a lot about what we can expect in the future. My name is Steve Letty, and very excited to be part of this with you. I really, really appreciate you joining us. I personally have been looking forward to studying this with you tonight. I kind of wish we weren't doing this just once a week. I just enjoy this so much. But again, Prophecy of Hope is a free community seminar. You're welcome to share this with others. It's an online gathering where all who are interested in learning about the Bible are welcome. We're going to be looking at prophecy about things that are concerning us today, and also looking throughout the history to show how the Bible prophecy has come true. This is, you know, really why we're here, and I trust that you will find this to be enlightening and hopefully life transforming as well. And we want to have some time to just get excited about the things the Bible are saying. But I want to pray with you before we begin, if you don't mind. So let's just have a quick moment of prayer. Lord, I pray that you guide and direct our time as we open your word, as we look at these prophecies. Give us wisdom to understand. You in the Bible say that spiritual things are spiritually discerned, which means that you help us understand these things, and we want that, Lord. Help us to understand. Give us wisdom again, I pray, so that we can not only learn these things, but have them become part of our lives and our future as well, and so that we're ready, Lord, for whatever you call us to do. We love you very much, Jesus, in your name, amen, amen. All right, so remember, if this is your first time, this will be new to you, but others who are joining us know that my promise to you every class is that I'm not going to be sharing opinions. That's not what this is about. We're going to let the Bible lead us. So this is our theme. You can repeat it with me if you'd like as I read it, wherever you are. But this is what I believe. If it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it's not in the Bible, it's not for me. We're not going to interject, the common held beliefs just because it's traditional believed either in a church or in the world. And so each night we're going to also continue to expose the mark of the beast and what is that. And I want to look again at the last book, the book of Revelation, and look at chapter 13 with you. It says this: he causes all, again, it causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave. So we again used this verse before. We're talking about this. There's a universal impact in this prophecy. No matter who you are, the beast is trying to force his mark on you all. Let's keep reading that section here. It says this: to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads. So again, in this short series that we're doing, we are bit by bit, piece by piece, letting the Bible expose the beast and his plans. But we also looked at a very important prophecy before, and what did it mean when we had the temple in the Old Testament? What did it mean when they brought sacrifices, when the sinner led a lamb into the sanctuary? And we talked about what this prophecy was. It was a prophecy pointing towards Jesus Christ, the ultimate lamb, the lamb in the book of Revelation. In fact, we talked about this. More than any other sign in the book of Revelation, Jesus is mentioned as the lamb. It's because of what he has done for you and me. He's given his life for us. He was the ultimate sacrifice. And because everything in the sanctuary points to the Messiah. In fact, everything in the book of Revelation in the Bible points towards Jesus and God. And especially, of course, the sacrificial lamb. Jesus himself came to be our sacrifice. And every lamb or sacrifice, again, pointed forward. It was thousands of years of actually living this prophecy. They would go, this would be part of the life of people in the Old Testament. And the beast desires to steal this gift. That he desires to take this away, the gift of the sacrifice that Jesus gave for us. He wants us to ignore it. He doesn't want us to understand its power. And it's time that we actually stand for Jesus and say, Jesus, you did everything for me, and now I'm giving you myself as well. But if it's up to the devil, he, instead of accepting the free gift of what the Lamb did for us, he will mark us as his conquered pawns. That's what he wants. He doesn't really care about us. He cares about winning and being Jesus and being like God. Tonight, we're going to be talking. In fact, I call tonight Ladies' Night in the Book of Revelation. I don't know if you know that there's a Ladies' Night in the Book of Revelation, but that's what we're doing. We're talking about the two brides of prophecy. And we're going to contrast two women, both in Revelation, and that's why we title this The Two Brides of Prophecy. And we'll be looking at some of the most shocking prophecies in Scripture. To help us set the stage with the two brides, though, if you have your Bibles, you can look in there. We're going to begin the Gospel of John to start, or you can follow along on the screen. But it says this in John chapter 14, verse 12. Jesus gave this amazing prophecy. I want you to listen to this. He says, "He who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father." Did you just read what I just read? I mean, believers are going to do what? Well, he said, greater works than these will he and she, of course, will do. So how in the world, I asked myself when I first started hearing about this prophecy Jesus gives us, how in the world can we who believe in Jesus do greater things than Jesus did? I mean, he is the King of the Kings, right? The Lord of the Lords. He is God, and we're just his humble followers. And you know, while it's true that alone and isolated, there's no way that prophecy is going to come true. It's just not, no way we're going to fulfill that prophecy. It's just not possible. But there is a secret to that prophecy. There's a secret to make that prophecy come true. And it's because Jesus is the head of the body. Colossians 1:18 says, Jesus is also the head of the body, the church. And he is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he himself will come to have preeminence. So he has come to have the first place in everything, the Bible says in other versions. Jesus is the head of what? What did he say? He is the head of the body, the church. He is the one that runs the church. So that's how we can do greater things than he did while he was on earth, right? Because we're part of this. Now you are, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. So together we make up the different parts of the body of Christ. And so that's how we could do such great things, because he is the head, we are the body. When Jesus rose to heaven, he said that he was sending his Holy Spirit. And through that Spirit, when we work together, we become this body that does the work of Christ. And so together, we can do great things. Together, we can actually then have greater works than these shall he do. And this is a sign of great leadership, great leadership. I was talking to one of my friends today about what is leadership. Leadership is not just having followers, but leadership is making great leaders. That's what the best leaders do. And it's exactly what Jesus did. Said, go make disciples. He's saying, you will do greater things than even I did while I was here. Why? Because we're connected together. We're spread out around the world. And as his body, the church will fulfill the prophecy of Jesus by doing greater things than he did on the earth. And again, I know some of you have been in churches maybe your whole life or for many, many years. Maybe some of this is new to others. But I'm guessing most people don't really realize that the church is a key figure in prophecy. And they don't realize what the church is actually for. And I want to look at a couple of other symbols in the Bible that uses to kind of prophesy and talk to us about what the church actually is. We need to understand what the church is so that we can understand this prophecy more clearly. It says this in 1 Peter chapter 2. It says, you also, like living stones, are being built into what? It says, into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. So we together as the parts of the body, but also now he's saying these living stones, we become the temple or the church, the spiritual house. And it's only when we do these things together and through Jesus Christ that we begin to see this prophecy come true, to do greater things. And so Jesus is continually showing us, and the Bible is continually showing us, that we are actually called to work together as a church. We make up the body, we make up the spiritual house. And again, a stone in a field is just a stone, right? But when you get enough of them gathered and you build them together as a master craftsman Jesus is, you can make great, great buildings, great cathedrals, and many things like that. So what does it mean? Well, I don't know if you came here to be shocked tonight, but I think we're going to shock you tonight. Are you ready? Now, seriously, are you ready to be shocked? Because this might be something that blows your mind a little bit. The truth is, the church is not for you. Did you hear what I just said? The church is not for you. What? You might say, what? If I'm a Christian, how can a Christian church not be for me? It's because we have been sucker punched by the beast. And he's tricked us into believing this about Christ's church. And to have a false sense of what church really is. And people always say stuff like, which church do you go to? Or, I'm going to church. But the Bible says that we are the body of the church. We are the living stones of his spiritual house. So the reality is, the church is not for you. You are the church. You see, you don't go to church. You are church. We together become church, the body, the temple built by living stones. And this is really, really fundamental in understanding the calling that Jesus has. If you just go to church, if we just go and do the things that we're doing traditionally for maybe decades in some families, centuries in others, and months in others, but just following traditions of going and which church do you go to, those things don't make sense biblically. That is not what we're called to do at all. We're called to be living portions of the church of Christ. It's very important. And when we're with Jesus, we truly then, as a body, as a temple, can do greater things than Jesus did while he was on earth, because we're spread all over the earth. He was in one location. He couldn't go everywhere. He was locked into the Middle East section that he was walking in. And so we are called, though, to spread around the world. And so in your region, You're called to be the church right where you are. And his church is making an impact with people everywhere around the world now. So let me ask you a question, if I could, today. Do you think that Jesus loves his church? Do you think he actually loves his church? Well, absolutely. In fact, Jesus calls the church his bride. He says that the church is his bride, that we are actually something that is very dear and endearing to him. It says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2, "For I have betrothed you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to who? To Christ." The Bible tells us the woman actually symbolizes his church, this chaste virgin. Paul is writing to the church, and he says that you, the church, are the chaste virgin, and you are presented as a perfect bride for Christ Jesus. That is exactly what the Bible talks about. The woman is always a symbol. And you know that there are a lot of symbols in Revelation. Revelation is written in symbols. And God uses these symbols to teach us. And one of these symbols is the chaste virgin, a virgin, the perfect bride, the woman in white presented to Christ. But there's another woman as well. And one of those symbols is this woman we call Babylon. We'll be looking at her tonight as well. And both women represent church. But one is the chaste church, and we're going to find out what Babylon represents tonight as well. So let's look at the Bible. Let the Bible help us determine what these symbols are. So let's look at Revelation chapter 17, if you would. And it says this, "So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a what? A woman sitting on a scarlet beast." So we begin this description of the spiritual Babylon found in Revelation chapter 17, 1. And you can go back and begin to read these things and view some of these things as on your own if you'd like. Really encourage you to study more in depth at these. We only have a certain amount of time each night. But obviously, this is a symbol. He's being led into the Spirit, the Holy Spirit's leading him to see these symbols. And we see a harlot sitting on this beast. You know, as you dig deeper, you'll find out it's a multi-headed beast. So in Revelation, there's these two women. You've got two women presented, the pure woman clothed in white, and the other is an adulterous woman. We see that it's named Babylon, riding on a beast. So what do these two women symbolize? Well, again, 2 Corinthians says, "For I betrothed you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ." The Bible tells us, again, that this woman symbolizes his pure and true church. And Jeremiah 6:2 says this, "I have likened the daughter of Zion to a lovely and delicate woman." So when you see a woman in not just a normal woman, but actually a woman in a symbol in the Bible, you know it's talking about this system of worship, this church. And so the daughter of Zion is a term describing God's people. And here, God compares his people to a beautiful, pure woman. And many times in the Bible, we'll read about God's church and his people represented as a pure woman. So we can see just now already these prophecies that the pure woman, this pure church, you know, that's what it represents. A pure woman represents a pure church, but a false woman, this woman riding the beast, represents a false church. And so these two women are actually two systems of worship. One are following the true way God calls us to live, and the other following this beast power. And so one of the things that we need to look at, again, is this Revelation chapter 17 woman. The harlot woman of Revelation represents a false system of religion, a church that's not faithful to her husband. Remember what it called her, an adulteress. She's supposed to be married to Christ. She's supposed to be following him. But no, this version, this church is the false church, one that is adulterous and does her own thing. And so it doesn't represent pure Bible religion. It's a system of false beliefs, and it's actually mixed with some of the pagan beliefs of the world. Again, though, you are the church. And so that you are called to do greater things, Jesus said. But the beast power has a false church riding on its back. And it's going to try and make sure that God's people do not do these greater things. So there's really a battle going on between these two women. This beast does not want you or me to follow our calling in any way. And so I want to take you now. I'm going to go kind of quickly through the history of the Bible, because there is a great calling on people throughout the Bible. There is a calling from the very beginning of the Bible all the way to the end times. People are called to make a decision. Are we going to follow the truth, or are we not going to follow the truth? And there are so many people and groups that were called to do amazing things. And I want to kind of look with you at the history of the Bible. We don't have time to read all these texts and all these stories, but I'm going to put on the slides the chapters in the Bible that you can find them. So I encourage you to get your cameras ready or have a piece of paper, and you just write down the chapter, the book and the chapter, or multiple chapters, and you can read about these stories for yourself. So you can, I always want you to check what I'm saying, because I don't want you just to believe what I'm saying. But I want to go back all the way to the very beginning, to the book of Genesis, and we're going to be looking at this first family that was chosen. If you know the story of Adam and Eve, God created Adam, God created Eve, and they were supposed to multiply and fill the earth. They were given so much, a perfect world. And God said, it's all yours to multiply and to have dominion over. But he said, one thing I don't want you to do. I don't want you to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Because if you eat of that tree, you will surely die. Now, if you know the story, a serpent, the devil, came and tempted Eve and then Adam to eat of that tree. And he said that you will be like God if you just eat of this tree. You're not going to die. Basically, he was saying God's lying. He's trying to hide something great from you. And why don't you be basically like God and do your own thing? And so they fell for that temptation and they ate the tree. They did their own thing instead of following God's truth. Now, how did that work out for them? Not very well, right? In fact, the original sin, all the problems that this world has had because of that, we experience this all the time. God wanted to give them the literal Garden of Eden, but they chose to do things their own way instead of following God's pathway. And then they have a couple of kids. And God is giving them a new direction. He even shows them through the sacrifice system. That's when the sacrifice system began. The oldest prophecy, really. The sacrifice system showing that Christ was going to come. And so there's two sons that they had, Cain and Abel. And Abel was giving sacrifices as God instructed. He was following and obedient, following the truth that God showed. But Cain was a farmer, the Bible says, and he did not want to do the things the way that God instructed. He wanted to give offerings the way he wanted. He wanted to do things his own way. And so we actually read in the Bible how that impacted them. It says this, that the Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering because he was obedient. But on Cain and his offering, he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. See, this is really what's at play right now. Listen, my friends, this is what's happening. The battle is really between not, I mean, there is these superpowers going on everywhere, but it's just really a battle of decisions. Are we going to believe God and trust Him? Or do we want to do things our own way? Do we want to make up our own pathway instead of following God's pathway? And so Cain was so angry, and even though God warned him there was consequences if he kept following on this path, he said this, the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry?" We know he's angry because he wanted to do his own thing. He was mad that God told him what to do. And God asks him, "Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it." So God was very clear about this. Still, Cain got so mad that he could not determine his own pathway. He wanted to do things his own way. He wanted to ignore God. He got so mad and so jealous that his brother Abel was following God that he actually ends up killing his brother. I mean, can you imagine doing that? He kills his brother. So far, this first family is not having a good track record, right? I mean, the mom and dad, Adam and Eve, they go their own path, and then Cain kills his brothers because he's so mad he can't do his own thing. But certainly if God chose an entire nation to follow him, you know, a very chosen group of people, certainly they would follow their calling, right? They would do things right, wouldn't they? Well, let's kind of take a stroll through the Bible. If you read Numbers chapter 13 and other chapters in the Bible, you'll know that God led his people out of bondage. If you read the book of Exodus, you'll read a lot about God's people were enslaved in Egypt. And their numbers grew and grew, but they cried out and they said, you know, "God, help us." And God listened to them and he helped them escape from Egypt. Even led them through the Red Sea. And he led them. He said he was leading them on a pathway to a land flowing with, the Bible says, milk and honey. I mean, this very rich, wonderful land. And so they get there. They get to this place. And he has this tremendous place for them. And God says, "Send spies." So they send spies into this land to check out the city of Jericho and the surrounding area to see if God was telling the truth. And when they come back, these are big, strong people. They're very physically, their labor was very physical. They had a lot of muscle on them. And the spies come back and they're carrying grapes, the Bible says. This bunch of grapes was so huge, it took two of them to carry one bunch of grapes. Can you imagine how big that was? How luxurious and fertile the land was. So the spies came and they reported, "Not lying, this place is amazing. It's the land flowing with milk and honey." So did they go in? Like exactly on the pathway? God said he was going to give them this land. But they didn't go in. What did they do? If you read, and again, read Numbers chapter 13. We're not going to go through all the text, right? But if you read through that, see that they said, "No, we can't go in because the people of the land are giants and they're going to squash us," they said, "like bugs, and we just don't have a chance against them." And so 10 of the 12 spies said, "We can't follow God's path." And the other two argued to go forward, but the people listened to the 10 spies that said, "No, we can't do this." And how did that work out? If you know the story, it didn't go very well, did it? Because what happened is God got angry that they would not continue the pathway he gave them, and he made them go out into the desert for 40 years and just wander around. 40 years, it's because he wanted the entire generation that disobeyed him to die off. and a new generation to be raised up to follow his plan. And that's exactly what happened. A new generation was risen, and then they entered that city. And if you know the story of Jericho, how many battering rams and how many catapults did they take to knock down the giant walls of this fortified city? Zero. All they did is worshiped. They went around and worshiped. They surrounded the walls, and every day for 7 days, on the seventh day, they went around seven times, and they blew a trumpet, which is a sign of worship. They followed, this time they followed God's pathway. And when they did that, the walls came down. God won the city and that entire land for them. So God had a tremendous plan, but it took an entire new generation, because the old generation wanted to do things their own way. They couldn't follow God's path. And so you think they've learned, right? Now that they have this land and kingdom is grown, you think they would learn their lesson, right? But what happened is they began to grow and get power, and they noticed that there was something different about them. They noticed that every other kingdom had a human sitting on the king. And they started asking themselves, who is our king? Where is our king? You know, we see, you know, this Syrians over here, they have a king. This group, all these different groups surrounding them had kings, but we don't get a king. They started complaining, we want a king too. Give us a king too. And just like Christ is supposed to be the head of the body of the church, God wanted over the people of Israel to be the head. He was supposed to be their king. But they kept claiming, and God isn't somebody who's going to force his will upon us. And so he allowed them to take human kings and have human kings. And if you read through the books of the Old Testament, you'll know that that didn't work out very well either. Most of the kings led the people into idolatry and far, far from God. But they did have, continuing to have these sacrifices. And what did all of those sacrifices point to in the Bible? Well, we've talked about it, right? They were waiting for the promised one. These chosen nation, the children of Israel, were waiting for the Messiah to come. And when Jesus came, and praise God, he did come. I mean, they've been doing these sacrifices, everything pointing towards his coming. When, you know, they were supposed to be waiting for him, they didn't even recognize him. They were supposed to be waiting for the promised one, but they didn't even recognize him. Jesus did come, but instead they demanded his death. And if you read through the Gospels, there's many chapters about this in the Bible and the New Testament. But if you read through the Gospels, they were surprised when strangers, the people who are outside of their camp, outside of this nation, we call them the three wise men, but we don't know if exactly three or not, but the Magi came. And they asked, where is the newborn king? Because they were reading the same scriptures that the children of Israel had, all of them pointing on this path towards the Messiah coming. And actually, the prophecies foretold of when he would come and signs of his coming. And that's why they followed the star, one of the signs of his coming, right to Bethlehem. And so when they came, they asked, where is the newborn king? Because they were following God's path. Even though they weren't part of this nation of Israel, the chosen nation that God had in the Old Testament. And so the people of Israel, how did they react when they heard that? They're like, what are you talking about? They freaked out. They began to search the scriptures. I mean, they read these things all the time, but they never put it together, because their religion had really become, for most of them, just a traditional thing to do. It wasn't in their hearts. They weren't really thinking about what was going to happen. They became cultural children of Israel, cultural Jewish people back in the day. And so they weren't really waiting for the promised one. But praise God, he came. And when Jesus came, he actually chose another group. And we call them the disciples, right? And the disciples lived with Jesus. And if you read through the Gospels, you'll see that Jesus taught them. He lived with them. He showed them how humble he was as a leader, how he healed people. And he taught them that those who want to be great need to be servants. And so after all this time living with God himself, being taught by Jesus himself, how did the disciples react when God showed him this pathway of sacrificial leadership? What did they do? Did they want to follow that path? Well, the Bible tells us no. They began to argue. They began to ask for places of power. They wanted to be the greatest disciples. They wanted to be right next to Jesus on his right hand and left hand because those were positions of prestige. They were looking for his kingdom coming, not as the great and glorious kingdom that will come, but rather they were looking for political power on earth. Even though Jesus had taught them all these things. It's just amazing how God time and time again shows his people the path he wants to follow. These chosen group of people, and yet they still want to do things their own way. They want to see the world, see things through the world's eyes instead of actually God's eyes. And Jesus, in fact, in Matthew chapter 16, we read that he told them what was going to happen to him, that he was going to sacrifice. He was going to be the sacrifice. He was going to die on the cross. And in Matthew 16, it's clear that he told them many times what the path that he was following was going to be. And so when the night came and he was in, if you know the story, he was in the garden and the guards came to arrest him. Did his disciples rejoice and say, "Yes, the time is here"? No, they ran away, right? When Jesus was taken to they call it the hill of the skull, Golgotha, when he was taken there and put on the cross, were they kneeling around the cross, thanking him for the sacrifice he was making? No, they didn't do that. 3 days later, he told them he was going to be raised again. 3 days later, how many of the disciples were waiting to see that stone in front of the tomb rolled away? How many of them were anticipating his resurrection? Zero. These were chosen people, chosen by God himself, trained by God himself. And yet all they could see was their earthly needs, and they couldn't see the incredible things that Jesus taught them. They wanted to see things from their own perspective, so they were hiding. They were afraid. They figured it was all over. Our leader is done. Even though they saw him raise others from the dead, they never pieced it together that what Christ was saying was true, that he was the great sacrifice. They wanted an earthly kingdom. They wanted him to overthrow Rome, and then they could be the governors of different provinces and such. And so all of these things, but Jesus, praise God, did raise, amen? And so you have the early church. I mean, because Jesus in Matthew 28 and in Acts 1, he gives them a new path to follow. He tells them very clearly what he wants them to do. And he says this. He says he wants you to wait. He told them, this is the plan. I want you to wait, and I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to you. And when the Spirit comes, then you're supposed to preach the word to Jerusalem, to all of Judea, to Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. He gave this clear pathway to the disciples. I mean, they're watching Jesus rise up into heaven as he's telling them this. It's a vital, vital pathway to follow for the new church. And so they did the first part. They waited, they prayed, and the Holy Spirit came upon them. And the Bible says that thousands were saved, and then thousands more, and thousands more. And in Jerusalem, so many people were being saved. So did they do what God said and went out and followed his path and began to go into Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth? Well, if you read Book of Acts, which chronicles what happened in the early church, you'll see that they didn't. They stayed right in Jerusalem. Now, I'm sure that they had, you know, great excuses, right? They may have been like, well, we're the mega church in Jerusalem now. We've got thousands of parishioners, and, you know, we're way too busy to go out and do anything else. I mean, I'm sure they had a thousand excuses why they just stayed right where they were. And in fact, God had to bring a persecution on his early church just to get them to go back out and do what he said. The stoning of Stephen began this, and the church, the Jews and the Romans began to persecute the early church. And so then they fled, and that's when the news spread around the world. I mean, it's just absolutely crazy, it seems. If you look throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament, God chose people over and over again, and he gave them pathways, but so many times they wanted to do things their own way. They didn't want to follow what God had asked them to do. Now we get to the end times, the very last days. You know, not the early church anymore, but now we're moved on to the end time church. And how will we react to God's call? How are we going to react when God calls us? And we just learned that we're supposed to be doing greater things. And how do we do that? We do that by working together as Jesus is the head and we are the body. We are the stones. How will we react when we know that we are actually biblically prophesied about? This day and age, we are in prophecy. We are called to be the church. Now, let me ask you a question. I want you to be honest with yourselves tonight. If in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, so many people were given this call to follow God's path, and time again, they decided to follow their own path, do you think it's possible, just possible, that we could be falling in the same kind of trap? Are we really so different? Has our church maybe fallen off the path that God has given us, the end time church, the people who live today who follow Christ? And if it happened to every other chosen group, are we actually immune today? Why do we think we're so different? And what would happen to the mission of the church if we followed our own path instead of following God's path? Well, just like the other groups, it affects the entire mission. It binds them from doing the things that God called them to do. It would keep us from our calling. And is that a big deal? Absolutely, it's a big deal. And so when we're looking at these two women following the true church, obeying God and doing what he called us to do, or following this false church, taking the wrong path is what that is. Following this church of confusion, not obedience, this church of adultery and not purity, then the calling that God has on his church in these days, it's bound up. It's hard for anything to get done when you're not following God. And so there is a book of warning in the book of James about following false religions and these false ideas. It says this again, adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore is a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Now that's not saying that you should isolate yourself. It's not saying don't talk to anybody who's not good. Because obviously Jesus hung out with everybody. And he mingled with people and sought their good. And he wanted to show them that he loved them. And people got excited because he cared about them even when they were sinners. No, this is talking about friendship with the world as friendship as in I want to follow what you believe, the world. In fact, instead of following the things of God and the things that he has sent from heaven for us to follow, I want to do things the way the world thinks is right instead of the way God thinks is right. And that's why, again, it's adulterers and adulteresses. It's those who are supposed to be married to God, the bride of Christ, but instead are married to are cheating on God in a sense. Yeah, with the world, doing the things the way the world would have them do it instead of the way God would have us do it. And so over the coming nights, we're going to dive deeply into both the sign we have when we join God in his church and the calling to follow him in a very special way. You know, I believe that Ezekiel the prophet would cry out if he was here today. I believe that he would say, many religious leaders have hidden their eyes from God's truth. I believe that John, the one who wrote Revelation, if he were here today, he would cry out to flee from the errors that have become part of the fallen church system, this spiritual Babylon. I believe that God is calling you and me, my brothers and sisters, back to his word. That he's leading us back to his truth, that God is leading honest-hearted men and women by the thousands. And I thank God that the Bible teaches us truth, that the more you study it, the more you are convinced that there's no way that these prophecies are accidental. The Bible knows exactly what's happening. The more time you spend in it, the more you realize how true it really is. And I thank God that the Bible says that Jesus Christ is coming soon, coming back for his people, that he's gone to prepare a place for you. And he said, I promise that I'm coming back for you. If I go to prepare a place for you, I'm going to come back so you can be where I am. And God will have preachers, and God will have church leaders, and God will have believers who will go get back into preaching from the Bible instead of just anecdotes and feel-good stories and trying to make people feel great just so that they start giving money or so that they can fill the pews and chairs of a church. That's not what it's about. It's about bringing people to Christ and helping them grow in Christ and to follow God's truth, to listen to his words, and to flee from unscriptural practices. We're called to be the bride of Christ, the pure and chaste bride, not the adulterous Babylon. And I believe that God is calling us back today to preach God's word. This is a prophecy that concerns you and me right now. And I know that God is pleading. Revelation 18, he says, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins. Jesus is calling us out, that we are no longer going to listen to churches or to religious, spiritual, or worldly things that lead us away from the truths of the Bible, that we're not going to do it. And we recognize that there have been called people throughout the history of the Bible since this world started that chose the wrong path. And fortunately, God has given everyone a chance to get back on that path. And he's talking, you know, when he says come out of her, he's talking about coming out of this false worship, this Babylon, those people who continue to teach things that are not in the Bible. They teach the traditions that were handed down to us, you know, not from the Bible, but from Greek philosophy, from world influences, and that have been mixed into Christianity. If you do your study and you begin to learn where some of these things began to creep into the church, back as early as the time of Emperor Constantine, where they began to change God's laws, we're going to learn about that, where they began to influence Christianity with pagan worship. And we're going to learn some of those things as well. It's very important. But, you know, Christ is a God of mercy. and he knows that people have been betrayed by religious leaders and been deceived. And he says, come out of her. And what does he say? Come out of her, my people. Even if we are sucked into this Babylon worship, this false belief, he still says, you're mine. I want you back. He loves everyone. And when he died on the cross, it was for every single person. This compassion, the tones of love that he says, when he says, come out of her, please, my people, lest you share in her sins. He doesn't want anybody to be drinking from the cup of that wrath. And you say, maybe I've been looking for truth. I'm a truth seeker, and maybe you haven't been satisfied. You know, this world can be very barren and a harsh place. Maybe there's something inside of you that knows that you're not going to find truth in what this world is teaching. You're not going to find truth from Hollywood. You're not going to try and find truth from, you know, these feel-good books. There's something more out there. Maybe you're thinking that, you know, I once was with God's people, but I've walked and I've kind of drifted away. I followed my own path instead. Maybe you've said, I've never really been happy with the walk I'm on. Or maybe you're one of those that feel a big emptiness inside. Maybe you're longing for something more. I think we all are, aren't we? If we really, really search, we're looking for something much deeper than what this life has given us. Something of substance. Something that you can just hold on to. That something is Jesus Christ. That's the void. He is the only thing that can fill that void in our lives. And maybe this lecture series is helping to stir some of those things. And maybe you believe like I do. I believe God brought you here tonight for a reason. I believe that God is looking upon us and he's excited that we're talking about these things. He's excited that we're seeing that there is a true bride and that it is an adulterous woman. And he's saying, I just know God is so excited that people are starting to wake up around the world and say, there's a true way of following God and there's a false way. Maybe you're a husband and you're all alone. And maybe you're a wife and you're all alone. Maybe you're like me when I came into, you know, the church, it just confused. Maybe you're the only one in your family that has any interest in this. It doesn't matter if it's with the group or by yourself. God is calling you. God is calling you. He brought you here tonight. And again, with tones of tenderness and love, he's asking you to come out of her. He doesn't want you to share in her sins, but he wants you to share in the freedom and the joy and the peace and the great reward of those who say yes to Jesus and following him. I'd like you tonight, if you would, when we pray, to bow your head. And I'm going to ask you to make just a special moment with God. And I want you to listen to him ask you to come out of her and to follow him completely. I want you to listen to him tugging at your heart. I want you to hear him saying, I want to be with you forever. And then answer him. He's asking you tonight to say yes to him. Will you say, Lord, I commit to follow you and only you. There is no other way. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, thank you so much for tonight. I ask you to please forgive us if we have followed wrong paths. Help us, Lord, to see your true path. Lord, the great news is you're the one that leads us on the true path. Your Bible gives us clarity. As we read it, your Spirit will lead us to understand it. So forgive us, Lord, if we've got caught up in false religions and the ways of this world. We don't want to be a friend to the world's ways. We want to be completely surrendered to your ways. And right now, you're calling each of us to come out of her, to come out of this confusion, to put the things that this world offers behind us and turn our eyes towards heaven. Lord, I ask you right now, listen to the hearts of those who are responding to you right now. We're going to take some time and just tell Jesus what you want him to know right now. Amen. Oh, praise God. Yes, yes. Amen. Lord, we commit to following you 100%. Thank you for these people who are making that commitment tonight. I pray that you help each and every one of us to follow you completely, to not be sidetracked, and to see your path lit before our feet every step of the way. Lord, we want to be your body. We want to be the living stones of this holy temple. We want to do the things you're calling us to do, things that are even greater than what you've done while you were here. And we can only do that when we do these things together and have you as the head of this church. We love you. We love you, God. And we thank you for letting us be part of this great, great journey. In your holy name, amen. You know, my brothers and sisters, one of the things you can do is you can invite others to help make a decision like this. That's one of the greatest things we can do as part of God's family, is to expand the family. And so we're going to send you links to the tonight's program, and you already should have, if you don't have them, we can send you the link, the other programs as well. But we want you to know about the things that the Bible says. And so that's why we have some more coming up from you next Friday night at 7 o'clock. We're going to talk about Satan's secret strategies. This is a really important one. We need you to understand that Satan has a plan for you. God has a plan for you, but so does Satan. But praise God, I'll give you a hint. God wins when people turn to him. He always wins. Satan can never defeat him. But we need to know what these strategies are so we can be looking out for them. And when they come, instead of making us afraid or leading us astray, when we know the strategies, they just strengthen our faith because we see it playing out, the prophecy playing out right before our eyes. So invite friends and family. We want everybody to hear the messages from the Bible. And then in 2 weeks, we'll be talking about heaven's gift today, that there's actually a gift that heaven is offering that you can have a part of right here on earth. It's very, very awesome. So we look forward to seeing you in just 7 more days. So that we can continue this great trip through the prophecies of hope together. God bless, and thank you for being here, Rob.